Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
So, let us begin our lecture. Today I am going to talk about the second law. Before that, I will briefly just summarize what we had done last time. Please tell me if you are able to see the slides, okay? Because I am trying out something different today. Are you able to see?
Yes.
Okay, I have tried the SharePoint today. Okay, last class we had talked about the variation of internal energy with the system variables. And if you look at the slides, which I have not yet uploaded, there was a mistake here. I had forgotten to take off this dt in this expression. Anyway, what we had talked in the last class was Joule-Thomson effect. What I'm going to do today is going to recapitulate whatever we discussed in the last class. Joule-Thomson effect is what we had said is actually monitoring of the change in temperature brought about by a drop in pressure when this gas is allowed to pass through a high pressure to a low pressure zone, and there is a condition is adiabatic, so we have an adiabatic expansion. So whether we are going to have a drop in temperature or a rise in temperature will be, we had said, is going to be decided by the coefficient mu jt, which is the Joule-Thomson coefficient. So in the last class we had discussed what the Joule-Thomson effect is, and I'm going to ask you a few things. Mu jt is the Joule-Thomson effect. Sometimes I have written mu, I have written mu jt. It is usually in the diagram which I've taken from Atkins. All my diagrams are taken from Atkins. If you want to go and check it, you can always go and refer to it. So here actually this is the mu jt, and I have said that we get a d when we plot the output temperature and pressure for each input of the pressure and temperature on the inlet side. So whenever the mu jt is positive, then we say we have a cooling, and whenever we are getting a mu jt negative, we say we are going to have a heating for the substance or gas which we are dealing with. This table which I have updated, you can see that usually we mention the conditions of 1 atmosphere and 298 K for the measurement of inversion temperature. Obviously it is going to change. It is the input temperature and pressure we are talking about, and under this condition you can make out which is going to have a Joule-Thomson effect positive. Under this temperature condition and pressure condition, whichever value of Joule-Thomson effect as a coefficient has a positive value, we say that gas is going to undergo cooling whenever we are carrying out the Joule-Thomson expansion. Similarly, if you can see the helium and hydrogen, here we have the Joule-Thomson coefficient negative. So in these gases, we are going to have a heating when we are performing the experiment of input of 1 atmosphere and 298 K. Okay? So, and we had talked about the two ends of the inversion temperature. This is the inversion temperature curve. And on this inversion temperature, the mu jt is going to be zero. Within this side, it is going to be positive. This side is going to be negative. So where this d is obtained, how did we obtain the d? We had said wherever the isothermal isoenthalpic curves have an inflection point, if those inflection points, if I join this locus of all the inflection points in the isoenthalpic curve, gives us the inversion temperature curve. On the inversion temperature curve, the mu jt value is zero. And this we call as the Joule-Thomson coefficient. So where is it utilized? It is utilized in liquefaction of the gas. So we had discussed in the last class the liquefaction of the gas through the Lenz process, where we keep on compressing the gas and whichever gas we are taking, we are trying to compress the gas and passing it through a throttle. And because of this throttle, there is going to be a pressure drop and we are going to have an expansion. This temperature, this gas is going to cool down, and this cool inlet gas is again used as an inlet for again compression and again pass through the throttle. And eventually at each consecutive step, we are going to get a cooling for the gases for which the mu jt is positive. And eventually we'll reach the critical temperature where the liquefaction temperature, where the gas is going to liquefy. So this is what we had talked in the last class. And I had given you this expression for you to derive. See, I have here used a van der Waals equation, and I can represent this in terms of the virial coefficients or virial equation as well. So I want you to try out to find out what is the mu jt value. From Maxwell's relation, we have got this. We are not going to talk about it how we got here. We are going to discuss this when we derive the deal with the Maxwell's equations. So I wanted you to derive this expression for a van der Waals gas. I would like you to extend that and derive it for the virial equation as well. That was the van der Waals equation, and you can use for the virial equation. Whatever I have shown here, it is a mixture of, this is the virial equation and this is the van der Waals equation which I have dealt with. And from there, we got this value as the mu jt, which I have asked you to derive. I'm asking you again, use the van der Waals gas equation as well as the virial gas equation to find out the mu jt term in terms of the A and B parameters of the van der Waals coefficients or the van der Waals constants, which we can talk about. And from here, we had predicted the value of the mu jt at high temperature and at low temperature. At high temperature, what happens to this coefficient is what we had discussed. And at low temperature, what happens to this coefficient we had discussed. At very high temperature, a very high temperature which we have, you see B is always going to be a positive number. The Cp is always a positive number. So the negative term here contributes to a negative value of mu jt. So at very high temperatures, we have a mu jt. What is the temperature we are talking about? This is the input temperature we are talking about. This is the input temperature we are talking about. So when the low temperatures are reached, T is in the denominator. So this term becomes small. So we have a positive number because all other terms are positive. So we get R is the gas constant. Cp is the Cp of the gas. A is the van der Waals constant of the particular gas. So all of these are positive terms, and this is going to be a small number, but it will be a positive number when we have low temperature. Low temperature means the input temperature. So the initial temperature we are putting in. If the initial temperature is above the inversion temperature, the final gas is obviously going to be, if the temperature is higher, then the heating is occurring. If the temperature is lower, then we have a cooling. I hope this is what we had discussed and all of you have understood this. And we had also talked about what will be the inversion temperature, because at the inversion temperature, the mu jt value is zero. So we had equated mu jt equal to zero, and we had found out what will be the inversion temperature in terms of the A and B. And we had talked about that mu jt depends critically on the constants A and B. These are the van der Waals constants of the gas. So each gas will have a different A, B value, which are the indices of the interactions which we have. And B is corresponding to the finite volume of the molecules. So depending on the interaction and the finite volume of the gas being introduced, we get the T inversion calculated. and the fine initial temperature which is supposed to be input should be below the inversion temperature. Only then we have observe a cooling, otherwise we have a heating observed. Okay, this is what we had discussed in the last class. I want to introduce one new term before we move into the second law. The new term is the Joule-Thomson isothermic Joule-Thomson coefficient. Isothermic, in the previous one which we had talked about, was the enthalpy was kept constant. What we had now trying to make use of is the modern way of finding the Joule-Thomson coefficient. The Joule-Thomson coefficient is now indirectly calculated using a heater. These days we have used this setup for finding out the Joule-Thomson coefficient. And before we find out the Joule-Thomson coefficient, I want to emphasize on the fact that we have introduced another term which is called the isothermal Joule-Thomson coefficient. And what is that? I have just put that value to be mu jt. Instead of mu jt, I have just said it is mu t. Now, enthalpy is as a function of pressure and temperature. So we can, since it is a exact differential, we can use the cyclic rule and find out what is the value of delta change of enthalpy with pressure at constant temperature. Change of enthalpy at constant with pressure at constant temperature is what we are defining as the isothermal Joule-Thomson coefficient. And how is that related to the Joule-Thomson coefficient? So from this expression we can find out what is the change of enthalpy with pressure at constant temperature. We take it to the other side and then it becomes reverse. So what we have, if you recognize this term, this is the change in temperature with respect to pressure at constant enthalpy and multiplied by the change in enthalpy with temperature at constant pressure. This you can identify is Cp. And if you remember your definition of Joule-Thomson coefficient, then this is the mu jt. So this is mu jt and this is Cp. So the isothermal Joule-Thomson coefficient mu t will become equal to minus mu jt Cp. Okay. So the other term which we can write down in terms of the total differential of the new equation we can generate of the change in enthalpy will be again the change in enthalpy with pressure at constant temperature into the total change in pressure plus how the enthalpy is changing with temperature with pressure into the total change in temperature. So this is the partial differential form which we can write, because it's exact differential, we can write it in this form. So what is going to be the change in enthalpy? Now I'm going to plug in the values of each. What is this is what we had called is this is the isothermal Joule-Thomson coefficient and this is Cp. So isothermal Joule-Thomson coefficient is nothing but minus mu jt Cp. So I plug in that minus mu jt Cp into dp plus Cp dt. Okay, so this is the new equation which we have. Now what we do in this experiment when we are finding out mu jt, here we are saying it's the isothermal process. What we are having, a gas pushed from a same pipe, sort of a system we use. We have a porous plug, we have thermometer in each side, and we have a heater. And this electrical heating which is required is actually going, if there is a drop in temperature, this drop in temperature is going to be compensated by the heater which we put in. So the cooling which is arising is offset or compensated by the heater which we have put. And we interpret that electrical energy which is applied is going to be proportional to the change in enthalpy. So if I have the change in enthalpy found out from the system, then I can find out the isothermal Joule-Thomson coefficient. And if I know the isothermal Joule-Thomson coefficient and I know the Cp, I can find out the Joule-Thomson coefficient of that particular gas. So here, this is the new technology which is being used. Here also we have a porous plank. We are also having a pressurized gas which is passed from here to here. But here the cooling is compensated by a electric heater. And this electric heating is required to offset whichever cooling is occurring due to expansion. And that is in that electric heat is or energy is interpreted as to be equal to the L delta H. And we know the drop in temperature. From that, we can find out what will be the isothermal Joule-Thomson coefficient. Am I clear? Okay. So this is the summary of all the expressions which we had discussed in this class. And this is a term which I have not yet derived. These two terms, how the energy terms, one is the internal energy, how it's changing with volume at constant temperature, which we have said for a ideal gas is equal to zero. But for a non-ideal gas, we have put this expression. For non-ideal gas, we have put this expression instead of pi, the internal pressure, pi t. And we are going to show that when we are dealing with Maxwell's relation, that pi t is going to be equal to this. And similarly, the change in enthalpy with pressure at constant temperature will be equal to, is actually equal to minus mu j t Cp. So we will see that minus mu j t Cp is actually equal to this expression when we are dealing with Maxwell's relation. So I'm going to finish off this lecture and start off with the second law. And these are the expressions I've derived for you. These are the summaries which I'm not going to discuss here. These are the summaries which we have done. And these are the response functions which we have taken into our, when we have discussed in detail, what is the internal pressure, what is the expansion coefficient, isothermal compressibility, Joule-Thomson coefficient, and also isothermal Joule-Thomson coefficient. So these are the response functions which we have, also Cp and Cv are response functions which we have discussed in detail. So now I'm going to move into the next slide, which is the second law. Can you move? Can you see all of you?
Yes.
Okay. So,
ma'am, before proceeding to the second law, can we practice some questions from the first law right now?
Right now? In the lecture class?
Yes, ma'am. Like if you give 2 minutes to solve and then explain if we are not able to do so or we have doubts. So.
But I have not got the questions right now.
So we will do it in the next class.
I'm going to give you some problems and which you can solve it in the and upload, or I'll give you the answers. I'm not going to give you the solution. I'm going to give you the answers which you can solve and verify yourself, right?
Yes,
I'm going to upload few first law, all the questions, mu jt up first law and CPCV, these questions I'm going to put. I have not yet made the assignment sheets because there is a lot of load in Moodle. I can, if required, I can upload in this Teams if it is possible. But you have to do the submission in Moodle only if you are submitting. Okay.
So, okay, thank you, ma'am.
So second law, I don't know how to begin with because entropy is something which is I'm very fond of and I discuss in great detail. But what is the first law which we had discussed in the previous classes? All the while we had been discussing, restricting our discussion on ideal gas, a closed system. And so far we have discussed the first law. And the first law says the different forms of energies are interconvertible. One form of energy, when it disappears, it generates equivalent of another kind. And it's a complete transformation of energy from one form to another form. And the total energy is conserved and remains fixed. So what we had taken, if there is a change in the heat in the, if the system is absorbing some heat, then the equivalent of amount of heat is supposed to be dissipated from the surrounding to the system. So the Q of the system will be always minus the Q surrounding. Q of the, if the work is done on the system, if you remember, if you are doing work on the system, then there is a lowering of weight in the surrounding. That lowering of weight, which is corresponding to the work in the surrounding, the work is done by the system or on the system. So if I'm doing work, if W is positive, W means minus PdV. If it is positive, then if there is a compression which we are talking about, then we are doing work on the system. And when we are doing work on the system, equal and opposite work is done in the surrounding. So this is what is the first law. This is what we obtained from first law. And obviously, the first law will say that the total change in internal energy will be equivalent to the heat which is either supplied or the work done. So whether it is supply, if it is if the energy heat is supplied to the system, then the internal energy increases. If the work is done on the system, then the internal energy of the system is increasing. When work done is done on the system, then this becomes positive and you have a increase in internal energy. So this is the first law, which we are not going to discuss any further. Why do we discuss, or what, why is the second law coming up? Second law, whenever we are talking about the first law, we are talking only about the total amount of energy being conserved. We do not know certain things from the second law, which is incomplete information from the second law, first law. It's the whether the transformation would occur at all or not. When we are talking about a process, we are taking from one state to another, whether the transformation will take place or not, and whether the associated energy is transformed at all or not. And if they are transformed, if there is a transfer of energy when we are moving from one state to another, which direction will it occur? And if the transfer is occurring at a particular direction, how long will it be sustained? Okay, so these, and if the transformation energy is occurring in a particular direction, how fast it is proceeding. So exactly how fast is not really going to be covered, but how, in which direction it is going to go is going to be given by the second law, and how long it is going to be sustained is also going to be given by the first law. This, as how fast is going to be the parameter, which is time dependent, which is really not covered in our discussion. So the second law is actually all the laws which we are talking about. These are not postulates, these are laws, and these are laws which are not does not have any mathematical derivation from Newtonian mechanics. All other laws will be following Newtonian mechanics. But these are the, because whatever you talk about will be followed by whatever the Newtonian equations you have for interpretation of your the law which you are talking about. But only first law and second law of thermodynamics does not have a Newtonian basis. Obviously, this may be, you can say to some certain extent, whatever you are talking about in second law is whatever you see is in the nature, that is naturally occurring processes are what we are going to interpret our laws based on. So all second law interpretations or formulations are all only determined by what we observe. These are all empirical observation based on which the law has been validated and proved. So what does the second law say? It is going to give us the preferred direction in which the energy transfer is going to occur, or the process is going to occur, and determines the process till which condition it is going to occur, till which point we can have the transformation from one state to another, and which is going to be the preferred direction, and till what condition it will occur. And according to thermodynamic processes, we can label them at three types actually. We don't talk about the impossible process. One is the naturally, which is occurring spontaneously. We do not need any intervention to take place. And that is the natural process, and we call that those as irreversible processes or spontaneous processes. And the other one is the reversible process. So an impossible process that cannot occur, and obviously impossible process, if it is not occurring, that means the direction in which we are trying to have the energy transfer or the state moving from one state to another is not preferred direction. That means the reverse direction will be the one which is preferred. So impossible process is actually the reverse of the natural processes which we are looking into. So what are the conditions which we are supposed to be questioning when we are having a second law? Why was it coming into the picture? Why do we have the question of having a second law? Suppose you have two similar kinds of liquids. They say benzene and toluene, they are very similar in their molecular structure. When we mix these two, these molecules are random and uniformly mixed together. They have a perfect ideal mixture. But the enthalpy of mixing becomes equal to zero. So if the enthalpy of mixing is becoming zero, whenever we have a mixing, there should be some driving force which is going to take the mixing forward. So if enthalpy of mixing is zero, then what is driving the formation of a perfect uniform mixture when two similar kinds of molecules are being mixed? Suppose we are talking about benzene and toluene. Okay, they do not separate into two layers. They are actually mixing like this in uniform to generate a uniform mixture. So what is driving the mixing? Similarly, suppose you have two bodies brought in contact. One is hot and one is cold. So what happens? We know that from observation, when we mix the toluene and benzene, you get a uniform mixture. Here also what we know that we have a hot body and a cold body in contact. After some time, we have the temperature of the two equilibrating, and this equilibria is reached only when a small amount of Q is flowing from one side to the other. Now, from our day-to-day observation, we know that the amount of Q which is going to flow is going to be from the hot to the cold and not the reverse. Reverse is the impossible condition. So, and the condition which is naturally occurring is the direction from a small amount of Q being flowing from the hot body to the cold body. So this is again a direction which is being put into from our natural observation, and that is what is going to, we are going to put a law to. So similarly, when we are having a gas, suppose we have gas, one is vacuum and one other we have gas, we have a stopcock. This we had talked about before. When we open this valve, then the gas moves completely to fill the two sides. This is how it is going to look. You have the uniform distribution. Pressure equilibrium is reached in two sides. The pressure of the gas in the two valves will be same. So what is happening? Here also the delta H is mixing is zero because we are talking about ideal gas. So if it is an ideal gas, delta H is equal to zero, then what is driving the gas from the high pressure area to the low pressure, that is vacuum? And why it is that we cannot obtain the gas coming out from this and distributing only into this side? That we can have if we have a device to make such that the entire gas is again evacuated and reached to the previous looking diagram. Like this one, it can be evacuated and again made this bulb to have the gas. But for that, we have to do something. This will not happen naturally. So whichever is not happening naturally is not the direction of the that's what we call the impossible form, and we need intervention to have this system to revert back to the system which we are looking into. So the two questions which is arising is enthalpy of the system increase or decrease, or if it is, does it increase or decrease, by how much? And does the system become more or less disordered, and by how much? So driving force is the molecular level disorder which we are generating in the system. And what is the molecular level disorder which we are talking about? We are talking about disorder increase in the following process. Suppose we have a solid which is melting into the liquid. We know the solid is much more in the compact form, and there all the atoms are in their, or molecules or atoms are in their particular position. When we have liquid, this order is slightly broken, so we get a liquid. So obviously the solid melting to liquid is a direction which is spontaneous, which will obviously a process which is we're going towards higher disorderedness. Similarly, a solid or liquid vaporizes to gas. Solid or liquid dissolves in a solvent to form a non-electrolyte solution. Substance is heated, increased temperature increases the molecular motion. So if we are heating some substance, you are going to obviously increase the in disorderedness. So whenever we are having a heat put into the system, we are increasing the disorderedness of the system. A chemical reaction proceeds with an increasing number of gas molecules. Is obviously, if you are proceeding towards increasing number of gas molecules, you are increasing the disorderedness of the system. So the second law puts forward the criteria for the direction of spontaneous chemical or physical change of a thermodynamic system. So, and the roots of this is, who was the first person to formulate such an observation? It was man is always, the human being is always trying to find a fabricator device which is going to make their work simpler. So that was the time when James Watt was working on the steam engine, and that is where this invention of engine came up. It was actually a steam engine. If you can visualize a steam engine, you have a furnace. From furnace, you are putting in the coal, and you are generating a steam. And the work which is generated pushes the engine forward. So what we had seen, that the work was fully converted to heat. But what was happening is, the question is, can the heat be completely converted to work? We have seen the mechanical equivalent of heat. We had seen the Joule's pedal pull experiment, where we said that mechanically, by stirring this water, we could generate the same amount of temperature rise as it could have been by putting it some amount of heat. That was the mechanical equivalent of heat. Now, that was for a closed system. So what we are now trying to find out, if I put heat, can it be completely converted into work or not? That was the question, and that was the one which we are going to look into right now. So what was the engine which was devised? It was a heat engine, and the primary application of the any thermodynamic system is to extract work out of a machine, and here we had the heat converted into work. So let us consider what this particular engine was designed. It is the typical Carnot's engine. What was happening, here we had a high temperature reservoir. This was the furnace. Some amount of energy from the furnace was applied to the engine. This is the engine which was devised. And this was a reversible engine which was devised, and from that we had work. So what happened was the observation that with the steam engine, whatever we are talking about, whenever you have seen a steam locomotive, you will see that whenever we are using some amount of heat from the furnace and supplying that amount of heat to the engine, it is supposed to do work and push the engine forward. But in the process, you must have also seen that you have a lot of exhaust gases. even for a gas for the engines which we have in our IC engines, in the internal combustion engines which we have in our cars, we have an exhaust pipe. So exhaust is something which is always there. Some amount of heat is dissipated to the from the system to the surrounding. So this is was the first observation which is made by Carnot. What he had said, what was the observation, that we, if I take some amount of heat supplied to the engine and convert that to work, I have to have some amount of work dissipated to the surrounding. I cannot have the entire work convert, the entire amount of heat which is taken from the reservoir converted to work. So this was his first observation, and that is also postulated. And the postulation or the wordings is actually the negative of whatever we see. Whenever we have the definition of the second law, it is actually saying that some amount of energy cannot be taken from the lower atmosphere to the higher temperature. Some amount of energy cannot be transferred to a high temperature reservoir without the work being done on it. That's a condition for a refrigerator. So I'm going to talk about it in a while, but let us discuss what we have here. In this engine, what we have, let us have a cyclic process, consider which is a cyclic process, a series of transformations brings the system back to its original state. So this is the first criteria which we have. We have a cyclic process, and the series of transformations are taking place, and the system is brought back to its initial state. And in the process, amount of heat which is absorbed by the system, let us say, you can say it Q1, at times I have written Q1, and it is actually to signify it is taken from the high temperature reservoir, I say it's QH, and some amount of heat which is dissipated to the sink or the surrounding is supposed to be at a lower temperature, or so we say that as QL, and the amount of work we extract from the system, we say, suppose designate at W. So what is the observation is the QH will be always greater than the QL. Okay, QH will be always greater than the QL, and what is done? The machine is doing work, right? Machine is doing work means the work is always going to be negative, okay? And negative work is what we are actually interested when we devise a mechanical engine, okay, or a heat engine. So what we are having, we have a standard engine which is reversible. That means we are bringing back the system through consecutive execution of consecutive steps back to its state in the previous condition, and it is operating reversibly. That means at each step of the change of each of the step is executed such a way that the quasi-equilibrium is maintained. We extract the heat from a high temperature reservoir and we perform work, and the machine performs work and dump the excess, which is heat, which is not converted into work, into the surrounding reservoir. And the temperature of the reservoir is supposed to be taken as constant. It does not change on absorption of or on giving up of heat. So this is the system which we are going to consider. And according to the conservation of laws of conservation of energy, what should happen? The QH minus the QL, whatever you have is the QH minus the QL should be equal to the work, right? So whatever amount of energy is absorbed minus the energy which is dissipated should give you the measure of the work, okay? And I'm not going to go into reading all this. These are there from taken from Atkins. You can always go and see it. But the system is operating between two temperatures, which is high and low, TH and TL. We are considering only an engine that is operating in cycles. That is, the system is returning repeatedly on repeated and subsequent execution is coming back to its original state. The engine operates in cycles and delivers work continuously performing over the cycle over and over again. This is the absolute requirement that the machine works in a repeated cycle over and over again. Otherwise, that machine is not of any use to us. Only one time work is not what we are looking into. We want a machine which is going to be operating. When we give amount of heat, it should produce some work. Okay? So it is operated on a repeated cycle, and the temperatures which we are looking into is always in the temperatures absolute scale, and the values which we are here also writing. I have also told you before that Q and W we are going to always write in absolute modulus terms, but you have to understand what does W and what does minus W and W mean, and what is Q and Q minus Q mean. Whenever you have a Q minus, that means the heat is dissipated. When you have Q is positive, that means Q heat is absorbed. Similarly, when you have W as negative, all throughout we will maintain W. If you are putting a sign as negative, then the work is done by the system. And when we have a positive, then we have work done on the system. We are doing work on the system. And the thermal efficiency according to that was, I'm writing it before, but we are going to discuss that in much more detail. So what is any efficiency of any system? It is what you get by how much you put. So what you are putting amount of heat, which is the absorbed amount of heat, and what you are getting is the W. Okay, so if we translate this into an engine, obviously that is known as the Carnot's engine. And Carnot's engine, I've said that I'm not going to discuss in great detail. So Carnot's engine is operated in how many steps? All steps in the Carnot cycle is a reversible step. And here also we are talking about an ideal gas and a piston. Gas piston, which is a system which we are going to look into. So what are the four steps we execute? And each of this step is carried out reversibly. That means if I, in any direction, if I move a delta to a P and P, V system, then I should revert back and change the P and V and come back to my previous state. So what are the four steps which are involved in a Carnot cycle? We have four steps, right? The four steps involved is where you are doing the work on the system, and the engine is doing work, and we are trying to find out what is the work done by the system, by the engine. In the Carnot cycle, we are dealing with the engine which is reversible, and the change we undergo take up consecutive steps and bring back this engine to its original state. And this system which we are visualizing is made up of ideal gas put in a cylinder fitted with a frictionless piston. So first step which is there in the Carnot cycle is the isothermal expansion, followed by the isothermal adiabatic expansion, followed by a isothermal compression, finally adiabatic compression. Okay, four steps: two isothermal steps and two adiabatic steps. Isothermal steps means I have to have two isotherms. Two isotherms means they are going to be this one step is going to have one temperature, and the other one is going to have the other temperature. Which one will be representing the lower temperature? Obviously, system, when we are dissipating some amount of heat, that is supposed to be for the lower temperature. But which curve will correspond to that? This curve is one isotherm. If you can see very, it is going to be. Okay, it is fitted. Can you see? Can you make out what is written? Yes?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So here you have a system where the bottom is not insulated, rest of it is insulated. Bottom is not insulated means I carry out expansion, and when I carry out an expansion, the temperature of the system should fall. So if the temperature is falling, then I do not have an isothermal system. So I subject this cylinder with the bottom in contact with the reservoir, which can supply energy in the form of heat, so that the system temperature is maintained constant. So this is the first step. In the first step, which is corresponding to this isotherm, the temperature is remaining constant in throughout this step. And what you have, we have a volume change from A to B, right? And along with this, what do we have? We have an input of QH amount of heat to the system at this stage. What happens in the second step? Second step, it is an adiabatic step, an adiabatic expansion we are carrying out. And in adiabatic expansion, what we have now put the insulation in the bottom. So the entire system is going to be insulated. When we are carrying out expansion in adiabatic condition, what will happen? The temperature will fall, right? The temperature is going to fall. So the temperature falls to a lower level, and this corresponds to the curve, which is supposed to be again isotherm, which is corresponding to a lower isotherm. Why do you have the curve in the lower side, not here as the TL? Can you make out? See, T is proportional to P. So if the temperature is higher, pressure is supposed to be higher. So which curve will be the higher temperature? You can make out this will be the higher temperature and this will be the lower temperature. Okay, because when we're having T is supposed to be proportional to the pressure. So whichever this is supposed to be higher pressure, so we are or inversely proportional to the volume. So you can find out which one will be the isotherm for the lower temperature. So this is the isotherm for the lower temperature, okay, and this is the isotherm for the higher temperature. So this is the place where you are having some input, and then we have the adiabatic expansion taking place. For the temperature falls because the system is adiabatic, and the expansion is taking place against the expense of its internal energy, and there is a cooling in the system occurring. Temperature falls. So it comes to this. Now we have this isotherm which is generated. The next step which we took to carry out is an isothermal compression. We are reducing the volume from VC to VD, right? And here again we have a heat input, but it is actually not input, it is the exit of heat. In this process, we have in input of heat at this step, two isothermal steps in which we have a input of energy in the form of heat. In the first isothermal expansion, we have an input from a higher temperature reservoir, and the some amount of heat is put into the system. The system gains the energy. And so the internal energy of the system must increase, the temperature of the system must if maintained constant. If the temperature is maintained constant, so the internal energy should be constant, right? So what we are having here, sorry, misleading you. So this is the place where you have isothermal condition. Isothermal condition means that temperature is constant, so the internal energy change should be zero. So what we have here, whatever amount of work we are having, is equal and opposite in sign to the heat which is absorbed. Similarly, which we have here, we have instead of absorbing heat, at this step, we have a rejection of heat to the sink. So in this place, you have QL, which is rejected to the sink. So this here again, we have some amount of work done. Here again, that temperature is held constant. So the delta U should be zero. So this delta U is zero. Again, W will be equal to minus Q. And here the Q is actually minus because we are dissipating the heat. And finally, from D to again, A is carried out through making the system again adiabatic, no transfer of energy in the form of heat from the bottom of the cylinder. So when we are taking out a compression, what happens? The compression means we are increasing the temperature. So the increase in temperature is going to be, this is going to be the adiabat we are going to generate, right? From D to A. So this is, you see the curve for PV curve is having a curvature. Here PV equal to the power gamma is a constant. So P is inversely proportional to V to the power gamma. So the fall in temperature is will have a curvature. So this is what we have from fall in temperature from this to finally, rise in temperature from D to A because we are carrying out a compression. So this is the four steps which we have. And I'm not going to look into the work and Q which is there. I'm going to come down to, though they are evaluated, but I'm going to come down to the final expression. So final expression, what is what we are having here? The efficiency is going to be the work which is the output by the input, which is the amount of heat which is supplied. And what is the work? Which is work is nothing but the difference between the amount of heat which is absorbed minus the amount which is rejected at lower temperature. So I can rewrite this as 1 minus QL by QH. Okay. What will be the delta U for the process? Delta U for the process will be zero. So we are not going to deal with that now. What we are going to come here is to find out what will be the efficiency. We have already discussed. Now what is going to be the work in each step and what will be the Q in each step? Because if I want to find out the efficiency, what I require here you see is QL minus QH. I'm interested in finding out the efficiency. So I need to find out what will be QL and what will be QH. What is QL? QL is nothing but the Q3 which we are talking about in the third step, and that is equal to minus W. And what is going to be the QH? It is the first step where Q1 amount of energy is transferred to the system. And this is the first step, so that's why I have designated as 1. And the work in the first step, which we say is W1. So here, since internal energy in both the steps will be zero, because both are isothermal steps, so internal energy is zero, so we can equate the heat in terms of the W. Q will be equal to minus W, or W will be minus Q. So here I have written down the values. What I am trying to find out, what will be the QL and what will be the QH, because I need to substitute that to find out what is the epsilon. Okay, so what is the epsilon which we can have a look at it? What is QL? QL is the Q3, which is the W3, and with a negative sign. What is the W3? The third step. This is the third step. QL is the third step. So this is the Q3, or which is equivalent to QL. Okay, and this is a adiabatic condition. Isothermal condition. So if it's an isothermal condition, the value of U will be, delta U will be zero. So here, in the third step, whatever Q is there is equal to the work done in the third step with a negative sign. So what is the work done? Work done is, this is isothermal system, and it is reversible isothermal, and we're dealing with the ideal gas. So it should be equal to, it will be equal to minus RT ln TL ln. What is the volume here? Final volume is VD, and initial volume was VC. So we can rewrite that. this is the one, and it, if it is minus, then the Q will be equal to NRT ln TL ln VD by VC. Similarly, I have to see the first step. Here also we had having the first step where you have the W or Q, which can be found out because we are finding out the Q1 or QH and QL or Q3. So the first step is isothermal, delta U equal to 0, W will be equal to minus Q. So here again we are saying the volume changes from A to B. So the final volume is VB and initial volume is VA, and it is going to be minus RT when T is TH, and since it is going to be opposite inside, the work will in the Q will be in opposite inside. So Q1 equal to QH will be equal to a positive of this, right? So if we plug in that, what do we get? If we plug in that, we get something like this. TL ln VD by VC, and here we have TH ln VB by VA. Okay. Now, this VB by VA and whatever we are looking into, we are supposed to look at the condition where for this particular step, how can we get VD by VC equal to VC by VA, VB by VA. This is the adiabatic condition. According to the adiabat, TH and TB, if you remember, you have to keep I better go to this curve. Yeah, this is easier to discuss. Oh, I have written C here instead of L. So what you see, according to the adiabatic work done or adiabatic expansion or compression, what you have, this is the adiabat which we have, adiabatic condition where I have TH, TB. Along the adiabat, which is the other one is C, B and C, okay, and volume is volume B and volume C. So according to the adiabatic conditions or adiabatic expansion or compression, I have the TV to the power gamma minus 1 is a constant, so I can rewrite that. This is becoming very difficult if I don't write it on the blackboard anyway. So TH TB to the power gamma minus 1 should be equal to TL VC gamma minus 1. It can be TL or TC, whatever. TC is confusing. It should have been written TL. I have to make it TL all throughout then. So this is the condition which we have for one adiabat. And the other adiabat is which one? This is the other adiabat. And according to that, what we have, temperature is again for TH and TC, TL. And for that, what you have, TH and TA, that is corresponding to this point, when VA is raised by gamma minus 1, and this is going to be VD gamma minus 1. So this is the adiabat we are joining, and according to that, we are having these two expressions. If I rewrite that in terms of the volumes, I say I can rearrange these equivalents and rewrite VB by VA gamma minus 1 equal to VC by VD gamma minus 1. In other words, VB by VA is equal to VC by VA, VD. So if we plug in this expression here, then what do you have? You have these two cancelled off, and you are having a term 1 minus TL by TH. And that is again equal to the efficiency. So if I, that means this side will be equal to this side. And if I rearrange that, I can rewrite this in terms of the this should be L. This should be L. I have made a mistake here. This should be L. This should be L. So QL by QT should be equal to QH by TH, and that is coming from here. Have I made mistakes here also? No, here it is okay. Here it is okay. Only while making the cross, I have rearranging, I have made a mistake. So this will be L and this will be L. So the sum of the heat which is absorbed or rejected at each step, I do not say heat ejected or heat substituted, I just say the Q or at each step of the Carnot cycle, if summed over, should be equal to zero. So if a parameter which we is in a reversible cycle comes back to its value, which is zero, that means that's a state function, and that is what we have generated. We are saying that over a cycle, if I sum all the values of Q in each of the steps by T at the respective temperature and sum it up, it should come to zero. Similarly, if I have an infinitely small steps carrying out, then instead of summation, I can obviously put it in the circular circular integral and say that the integral over a cycle for all the values of Q by T should equal to be a constant. And this we say is a state function. So once it is done that, I'll take a gap of few minutes and then we'll start again. Okay.